Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good morning. Let's say it together. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is so good to see each and every one of you here today. I want to welcome you to White Oak Baptist Church. I'm glad that you are here and ready to worship King Jesus. I want to remind you that during greeting time in the Crossover Building and in the Huff Building, you can go to the necessary rooms there if you need to. Also a great time to silence your cell phone. And if you are giving today, the offering plates are up front and in the entrances. We have lock boxes there for your giving as well. We have so many prayer requests this morning that I'm not going to mention any by name because I will forget someone. But we have a lot of needs this morning. I want to welcome all of you who are here, those who are headed this way, and those who are watching on Facebook Live. It is great, great, great to have you today. Let's leap to your feet. I know you can. Leap to your feet. I'm going to pray. Right after I pray, we are going to worship King Jesus. Let's pray together. Father God, God, we bow before you and we thank you so much that we can be right here, right now. Lord, as a church and as individuals, we have so many needs on our heart. And I pray, God, that you would be with each and every one in a very special way. Father, I thank you that you have brought us all together this morning here in this building and many who are watching online. Dear God, I pray that we might lift our hearts and our voices to our God. Father, I pray that when we get to the time in the Word, that you would just bless that time. We love you, we praise you, we worship you. You are our God, and there is no other. Bless this time as our prayer in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Amen.
I do want to mention our next Chain Breakers Addiction Bible Study is Thursday, August 29th at 6 p.m. Dinner is provided, so if somebody that you love or yourself struggles with addiction, this Bible study is for you. Let's worship King Jesus this morning. Can he move every mountain? He defeats the darkness. Let's sing to him this morning.
Sometimes I wonder, is he faithful? Does he see me in my trouble? Does he understand? Sometimes I question if he's able. Can he rescue? Can he save me again and again? But when I look back, did he move every mountain? Did he part every sea? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Did he defeat the darkness? Did he deliver me? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Sometimes those voices try to tell me I forgot. Yeah. Did he defeat the darkness? Did he deliver me? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Yes, he did. So yes, he can.
All right. I see a lot of new faces here this morning, and that's great. We want to welcome you to White Oak Baptist Church. We're going to greet each other at this time, so make sure you say hi to all the new faces.
Is my mic on? Hello?
If you'll make your way back to your pews and remain standing.
Please come through.
we're going to continue worship with a song called God Help Me. If you've ever felt like God has forsaken you or he's not there during a troubled period in your life or through tribulations, this song is the epitome of that. And when we don't know what to pray, sometimes we just need to call out, God help me.
Tears pouring down, and I can't see past what's in front of me now. When it's all too much for this heart to take, there's one name I call, one prayer that I pray.
We're going to sing, I Speak Jesus.
Just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Yes, I will.
Thank you.
fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things.
Up this morning, and I'm not going to tell you guys because I'm going to challenge you to look up the reason that this song was written. But in any troubled times, we can always remember that our foundation is Jesus and the anchor is always going to hold.
Journey through the long dark night, out on the open sea, by faith alone. Watching me, the anchor holds, though the ship is battered, the anchor holds, though the sails are torn. Dream.
Said amen and amen. As our kids make their way back to Kids on the Rock this morning, if you would take your Bible and turn to Psalm chapter 10. Psalm chapter 10, and I want to preach a message entitled "Hello, Anybody Home?" Hello, anybody home? As you know, on Sunday mornings, we are in a series that we have simply called Summer in the Psalms. We are preaching a baker's dozen. We are preaching the first 13 psalms in the book of Psalms on these Sunday mornings, and we've made our way to chapter 10. One of the reasons that we are in the Psalms in the summer is because they show the greatness of God. They show the majesty of God, and they show the vastness of our great God. And what that does is that it leads us to worship. This morning we have been singing, and my heart has been blessed because I know what I'm about to say. And each and every song has gone exactly with what this psalm is all about today. David, probably the author of this psalm, most theologians believe, the psalmist asked two very important and very personal questions. These questions this morning are raw, and they are real. There are questions that you have asked and questions, honestly, that I have asked. Sometimes we ask these questions through aggravation. Sometimes we are annoyed when we ask these questions of our God. And sometimes, to be very honest with you, we are even angry when we broach the subject with our God. Sometimes it's through groaning. Have you ever been praying and you can't put the words together, and so you're groaning? Sometimes it is through that. Sometimes it is through tears and sobbing. Because we're human, there are times when we are truly shaking our fist at God, because we don't understand. We have questions. This is 2024, and I became your pastor in 2009. When I first got here, we owned a home in Fairfield Glade, right outside of Crossville, and I just knew that we were going to sell that home just like that. And so we came, and we began to live with Leslie and Terry's mom and dad, and 1 week turned into two, and 1 month turned into another, and we did not sell that house. And so we left there and went to the aunt's house, or it was vice versa. And so it was lingering on and on and on. And if you glanced into my prayer journal during that time, there were times I would say, "Hello. Anybody home?" I mean, I was like, I can't believe this. It has extended, and it has extended. And you know, some of you are here right now. After we moved from Bryn's to the mom and dad's, that's how it was. And before we rented an apartment, some of you went on vacation, and I took over your house. And thank you for that. I really appreciate that. We wanted to go anywhere. We just needed somewhere to be. And then we rented an apartment, but my prayer journal was full of, "God, where are you?" Took 3 years to sell that house. 3 years. Since then, in the ensuing years, you know that I lost my mom, and I lost my dad, and I lost my sister. I lost Leslie and Carrie's mom, and Leslie and Carrie's dad and aunt. And my prayer journal over and over and over: "God, where are you?" Have you ever been there before? Have you ever been there before where you're crying out to God, sometimes with groans, but sometimes, honestly, in anger? There's where the psalmist is. And so what I want you to do with everything that we've been singing, I want you to turn to Psalm 10 and allow your eyes to fall on verse 1. And I want to read these 18 verses, and this will be our text today. Psalm 10, beginning in verse 1. Listen to these two questions. "Why do you stand afar off, O Lord? Why do you hide in times of trouble? The wicked in his pride persecutes the poor. Let them be caught in the plots which they have devised. For the wicked boasts of his heart's desire. He blesses the greedy and renounces the Lord. The wicked in his proud countenance does not seek God. God is in none of his faults. His ways are always prospering. Your judgments are far above, out of his sight. As for all of his enemies, he sneers at them. He has said in his heart, I shall not be moved. I shall never be in adversity. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and oppression. Under his tongue is trouble and iniquity. He sits in the lurking places of the villages, in the secret places. He murders the innocent. His eyes are secretly fixed on the helpless. He lies in wait secretly as a lion in his den. He lies in wait to catch the poor. He catches the poor when he draws him into his net. So he crouches. He lies low, that the helpless may fall by his strength. He has said in his heart, God has forgotten. He hides his face. He will never see. Arise, O Lord. Look at your neighbor right now. Look at your neighbor and smile real big. Smile and go, arise, O Lord. Say it real loud. Arise, O Lord. Hey, listen. This is where the psalm sort of turns. So look at your other neighbor, your second choice. Look at your other neighbor and say this. Say, arise, O Lord. Arise. All right, you're not going to do that. Look up here at me. Come here. Come here. Say that together. Arise, O Lord. This is where it turns. And I want you to see this. It's amazing. Arise, O Lord. O God, lift up your hand. Do not forget the humble. Why do the wicked renounce God? He has said in his heart, you will not require an account. But you have seen. For you observe trouble and grief to repay it by your hand. The helpless commits himself to you. You are the helper of the fatherless. Break the arm of the wicked and the evil man. Seek out his wickedness until you find none. The Lord is king forever and ever. Can you say amen right there? The Lord is king forever and ever. Amen. The nations have perished out of his land. Lord, you have heard the desires of the humble. You will prepare their heart. You will cause your ear to hear, to do justice to the fatherless and the oppressed, that the men of the earth may oppress no more. Let's pray together. Father God, in the name of Jesus, one more time, we bow before you. Father, I thank you this morning that your word is alive. And dear God, on every pew in this church, and those who are watching at home, no matter where they are, I pray that this word hits us all, dear God, between the running lights. Father, I pray that it would come alive to each and every heart, beginning with my heart. Oh God, I pray today for clarity of thought. I pray today for excellent recall of the things that I've studied, those things that I've bathed in prayer. And Father, I pray today, if you would you one more time just draw a circle around this preacher and let the fire of heaven fall? For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There are two things that I want you to notice in this passage of Scripture this morning. First of all, simply this, the frustration declared. The frustration declared. You can see it in the heart of the psalmist. Notice what it says in verse 1 of our text again. This complaint, this lament. Look at what it says here. Why do you stand afar off, O Lord? Why do you stand afar off, O Lord? In other words, God, why are you absent right now? Why do you seem aloof to me? Father, why does it seem like you have abandoned me? Why are you avoiding me? Why, when I pray, do the heavens seem like they're brass? Have you ever been there before? Why, God, why are you distant? Why have you deserted me, God? It's almost, Father, it's almost like you are a fair weather friend. You are missing in action. It's like you are unconcerned. It's like you have withdrawn yourself from me. Have you asked that question? I promise you, if the answer is no, there will come a time in your life where you will ask that question. I promise you that at some point in your life, you're going to ask the question, where are you, God? Where are you at? As you bow and as you write in your prayer journals and as you try to form prayers to our holy God, and he seems like he is nowhere to be found, you say, as the psalmist did, why are you standing so far off? Oh, Lord, where are you? And then this other question here, why do you hide in times of trouble? We saw that phrase earlier in the Psalms, in times of trouble. And that phrase means to be cut off. And what the psalmist is saying here is, it's almost as if I'm cut off from all hope, Lord. I am in despair. I'm cut off from anything that I can grab a hold of. And so he says, why do you, in times of trouble, why is there despair right now in my life? I would say it like this. God, when I need you most. Father, when I need you most, where are you? Just this week, if you live here in Chattanooga, you watched on the news where a young lady, 20 years old, first name Autumn, she was in an automobile that her boyfriend was driving. And a car part flew off of the car in front of them, went through the windshield, and killed her. 20 years old. I'm telling you, there are times like that where you say, God, at times of trouble, God, where are you? Where are you? Some of you are here this morning. I want you to listen. Listen, some of you are here this morning and you're brokenhearted. Some of you are here this morning and you have been gut punched. Some of you are absolutely, you're just lonely this morning. Some of you, and you can fill in the blanks, and so you understand what the psalmist is saying. And this is the reason, because God, listen, God is not responding the way you thought God would respond. You thought you knew God better than that. But can I tell you what? Sometimes God's ways are not our ways. They're just not. We find that in the book of Isaiah. It'll be on the screen, Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9. Look at what the Bible says. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. Look at verse 9. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. Corrie ten Boom puts it like this on the screen. It says this, when a train goes through a tunnel and it gets dark, you don't throw away the ticket and jump off. You sit still and trust the engineer. Some of us are there right now. Some of us are there right now where we're going through maybe you're going through a tunnel of chaos and it is very dark and you just have to trust the engineer. That's what's going on here. The psalmist, honestly, he was just frustrated and he was declaring this. He really was. He was asking these very raw questions. You have been there. I have been there. You may be there right now this morning. These very real questions. And can I tell you what? It gets worse. Look at me, you're saying, you are bumming me out this morning. How in the world can it get worse than that? Let me tell you, the psalmist lays it out. That's how. It's almost as if the wicked get a hall pass. I mean, we're up and we are having our quiet time. We are drinking our Maxwell House coffee because it's the greatest coffee on earth. And we're having our quiet time and we're with Jesus and we're singing hymns and we're going to church and everything's, I mean, we're just doing all that we can. And then things are coming against us and we are praying this prayer and we look over at our neighbor and he is mean as the devil. Not your neighbor. But mean as the devil, and everything is just going hunky-dory for them. And so you're sitting there going, oh my goodness. You see, what David does, or what the psalmist does, is in the next 10 verses, he lays out a resume for the wicked. He gives a profile for the wicked. The first thing he says is this: the wicked, man, they're proud. The second thing he says is the wicked, they prosper. And the third thing he says is, man, they just persecute people. I want you to see it in your copy of God's Word. Notice what it says in verse 2. You'll see the word pride and boast in these verses here. Notice what it says. The wicked, notice this, in his pride persecutes the poor. Let them be caught in the plots which they have devised. Notice this. For the wicked boasts of his heart's desire. He blesses the greedy and renounces the Lord. The wicked in his proud countenance, notice this, does not seek God. God is in none of his thoughts. God, the wicked, they're just proud. How can everything be going great for them? I mean, they don't desire you, God. They don't depend on you, God. They don't even pray, but things are going great. They're arrogant. They're conceited. They're cocky. Their life is full of hubris. How in the world can it be going so great for them? They're so full of pride. They've adopted that Frank Sinatra song, I did it what? My way. I did it my way. And things are just, it's amazing. The Bible talks about pride. Notice what it says in Proverbs 16 and verse 18. Pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. And then in Isaiah chapter 2, notice what it says in verse 12. For the day of the Lord of hosts shall come upon everything proud and lofty, upon everything lifted up, and it shall be brought low. And then in James chapter 4, it says this, but he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And we know those verses. Don't we know those verses? But everything seems to be going great. Can I tell you, comparison is the thief of joy? It is. When you look out your window and or your co-worker, comparison is the thief of joy, because not only do they seem to be proud and getting away with it, but they also seem to prosper. Notice what the Bible says in verse 5. His ways are always, notice this, prospering. Your judgments are far above, out of his sight. As for all of his enemies, what does he do? He sneers at them. He has said in his heart, I shall not be moved. I shall never be in adversity. In other words, he feels invincible. And he just, if anybody's going to get the promotion, guess who gets the promotion? If somebody's going to get a raise, guess who gets a raise? Have you ever noticed that the wicked, those who are mean as the devil, they can get run over by a train, get up and dust off, and they're okay? You ever notice that? But yet we're going through trying times. And I said a moment ago, and it's so true, when we compare our lives to others, it's a dead end. I heard about a preacher who really loved taking care of his yard. He enjoyed cutting his lawn and taking care of his yard, and some of you don't. Some of you don't cut your yard until you lose your dog. I understand that. But there, you know, some really enjoy it. And this preacher loved to take care of his yard. He enjoyed it. And so he would do that, and he noticed that his neighbor, who also took care of the lawn, he noticed that they had a sign in the yard, and it said, Yard of the Month. And that just flew all over him. His preacher was like, how in the world? I mean, my yard is better than his yard, and yet he got in our association here, our neighborhood, he got Yard of the Month. And so that next month, he did even more. He planted flowers, and he did all that he could do. And the next month, at the beginning, he looked over there, and that sign was still there. The guy had the sign again. So he met the guy at the mailbox, and he said, listen, I just got to ask you a question. I don't mean to be mean, but my yard is as nice as your yard. How did you win Yard of the Month again? And the guy looked at him, and he said, oh, I bought that at Hobby Lobby. When we compare our lives with other people, it's a dead end. And that's what the psalmist is saying. He's asking these questions. God, where are you? My heart is broken. Where are you? You are absent. You are missing. And not only that, but man, the wicked, they prosper. They're full of pride. And then they persecute. Notice what the Bible says beginning in verse 7. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and oppression. Under his tongue is trouble and iniquity. He sits in the lurking places of the village. He just goes over and over and over. The Bible says in John 8 and verse 44, listen to these words. John 8, 44. You are of your father, the devil. And the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. Well, that just lays out the truth. And then in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8, the Bible says this, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And what the psalmist is laying out here is, listen, those folks are just like their father, the devil. There is a wake of wrecked lives in their lives. He just goes on, and he says in the B part of verse 8 in our text, in the secret places he murders the innocent. His eyes are secretly fixed on the helpless. He lies in wait secretly as a lion in his den. And he just, oh man, he just over and over and over and over. And so he's declaring how frustrated he is. But when you get down to verse 12, we see that he begins in frustration, but he doesn't stay there. Thank goodness. Because the second thing we see in our text is this, the faith that is demonstrated, beginning in verse 12, the faith that is demonstrated. Look at verse 12. The Bible says, arise, O Lord. O God, lift up your hand. Do not forget the humble. And so, in boldness and in courage, now it's sort of shifted in his life. Because he realizes something. Paul puts it like this in Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. Look at what it says, Philippians 2, verses 10 and 11. And at the name of Jesus, look at this, every knee shall bow, of those in heaven and of those on the earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We looked at that this morning in our 929 small group. We know this to be true. One of these days, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus is Lord. One of these days. And so here, this faith is being demonstrated as he continues to sing, as he continues to write. He's saying, oh, God, would you lift up your hand? And I want you to notice two things here. Two things, and I want to encourage you to underline them in your Bible. Look at what it says in verse 14. Look at this. But you, notice this, I've got it underlined in my Bible. You have seen. You ought to underline that. You have seen. And then, Ginger, go down to verse 17. Verse 17 says this, Lord, you have heard. And so what the psalmist is saying is this. It may appear like you are missing. It might appear like you're not paying attention, but oh, you've seen. And oh, you have heard. Not on the screen, but it just came to my heart. I think it was Spurgeon that says, listen, when you can't trace God's hand, trust his heart. When you can't figure it out, know that our God cares, that he is in control. That he really, really is in control, and that he's not going to forsake you. The Bible says in Psalm 9 and verse 10, and those who know your name will put their trust in you. For you, Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. You've not forsaken those who seek you. Psalm 34, notice what it says in verse 18. The Lord is near to those who have a broken heart and saves such as have a contrite heart. And I love what it says in Matthew 28. Notice what it says in Matthew 28, verse 20. Teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always. Jesus said, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So no matter what we're going through, there are times when, honestly, because we're human, we are frustrated. Can I tell you what? I told you I was never going to say this, but it's been several months now, and I've about come to grips with it. I'm 60. I said I was never going to say it again, but I've been thinking about it. I'm 60. And I started preaching when I was 19 years old. 19. I got into youth ministry. And I started pastoring when I was 26. I've been pastoring all these years. And you look at me and you say, you know what, Brother T? I bet when you're eating your oatmeal in the morning, the brown sugar and stuff like that, or you're drinking that protein shake, I bet you hear the hallelujah chorus when you're doing that. I bet everything's just great. No problems whatsoever in your life. Yeah. Follow me around just a little bit. I don't know how long I've been journaling, but for years and years and years, I have them stacked up. And I can tell you, I love to take those journals off from time to time and just open them up and read through them. Where I was in a mess, and I was crying out to my God, God, where are you at? And I would like to say that every one of those prayers have been answered, but you know what? They have not. A lot of them have. A lot of those cries have been answered. Some of them have not. So what do? One of the hardest things in life is when you're doing the spiritual disciplines, and yet there are some things that have not, God has not responded the way you think or thought He should have responded. What do you do? A.W. Tozer said this: faith is not a conclusion you reach. It is a journey you live. And Elizabeth Elliot said this: don't dig up in doubt what you planted in faith. I don't know where you are in your life right now, but I know that on every pew there's a heartache. And when you reach your life, and there are times where you're looking up at glory, you're going, hello, where are you? I want to remind you of something. Take your Bible and turn to Psalm 22. Psalm 22. Take your Bible. If you've got a floppy Bible like me, take it. If you've got a device, flip it on. Psalm 22. And I want to show you something. Psalm 22 is a messianic psalm. Jesus on the cross of Calvary, fulfilling prophecy, said these words. David wrote them many years before. Psalm 22 in verse 1, it says this: my God. Jesus said these words. He was praying to God the Father. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning? When you reach a point in your life where you have not received the answer yet, can I tell you what? Jesus from the cross prayed the same prayer. But thank God, 3 days later, up from the grave He arose. He prayed that prayer: God, why have you abandoned me? Why have you turned from me? But 3 days later, up from the grave, He arose. And I just want to say, in your life and in my life, there may be times where we don't receive the answer, but there is a resurrection day a-coming. There is a day a-coming, and that is not a cop-out. That is the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because Jesus died on the cross of Calvary for you and for me, and because He was buried in a borrowed tomb, and because of 3 days later, up from the grave, He arose. We have victory in Jesus. We have victory in Jesus Christ. Thank God for that. And so when we say, hello, where are you? Thank God sometimes we get the answer on this side, but if we don't get it on this side, I guarantee you we will understand it all by and by. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Some of you today, no one's looking around. Absolutely nobody looking around this morning, but in your heart, Maybe you're here, and maybe you're going through something in your life right now where you're saying, God, where are you at? Where are you? Why don't you come today? Just get on bended knee at this old-fashioned altar. Why don't you come today and say, oh God, I don't understand, but I trust you. Maybe you're here today and you have never given your heart to Christ. Maybe you're here today and you have never called upon the name of the Lord to be saved. Maybe today is that day. You just need to come. Take Pastor John T. over here by the hand. He'll be glad to pray with you. There are others here and you have been saved, but you need to be baptized. We're going to baptize next Sunday morning. Krista down here on the front row this week gave her heart to Christ. Can you say amen? She gave her heart to Christ. Her life has changed. I see it in her life. Next week, we're going to baptize her. Maybe you need to be baptized here as well. Maybe you have a burden on your heart today. Why don't you come? Cast all your care upon Him because He cares for you. Very quietly, very reverently, would you stand? Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Just stand all over this auditorium. Stand and I'm going to pray. Right after I pray, I invite you to come. Father, God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I pray that you would speak to all of our hearts. Father, I just pray that you would show us truth from your word. Lord, I pray that you would move and that we would respond. Thank you for your word. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Jennifer, lead the praise team as they lead all of us. And as we sing, would you come?
Purify my heart.
God has spoken. This is the time for you to respond.
Let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart. Let me be as gold, pure gold. Is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my Master, ready to do. Purify my heart, cleanse me from within, and make me holy. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin. Deep within, refiner's fire. To be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my Master, ready to do your. be as gold. Your gold, refiner's fire. My heart's one desire is to be.
This week would massage our hearts, Father. And Lord, as I said a moment ago, Father, as I said a moment ago, when we can't trace your hand, when we don't understand that we would trust your heart because you're good and you're God. So, Father, I pray that you would move. As our instruments continue to play, if God has spoken to your heart, you come.
Week that goes by that I have been reminded, either in God through God's word, but also just through life, that the enemy's attack is real, and the primary place that he is attacking is the home, and this is home too. It's our personal home, but it's also, this is our corporate home. And there are many days that we say, oh God, why? Many days where there is no answer. But there are many days the answer is you're not alone. Just keep going. And so as we close out and we head out of here today, let's head out realizing that we are a family. And there are many in here that are hurting. And just like in our own homes, when one hurts, we all hurt. And so let's walk together and see God do a work as only He can. Patrick, would you close us in prayer? Would you mind doing that?
Give us that peace that no matter what.